Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the meeting this evening. This is the public session, and we do have a few speakers. Excuse me? We have a few speakers who would like to address the assembly. I'm going to call your name. Keep your comments to roughly 5 minutes or less. We need your name and your address, and speak freely about anything that's on your mind. The first speaker is Frank. Frank Timpson. Timpson, are you here? Okay, well, we'll go to the next one. Ellen Clark. Ms. Clark?
Hi. My name is Ellen Clark, and I'm the chair of the Promotion and Tourism Advisory Board for the city. The board was put in place September 2014 with Nate Emmons as the chair. I accepted Mayor Gillen's appointment as chair of this committee in July of this year as Nate stepped down to pursue other ventures. The mission of our board is to develop a strategic and tactical platform to promote the city of Oswego's cultural, historic, and recreational attractions and to promote the quality of life. Some of the challenges that the board has taken on include how to utilize the waterways more effectively, ways to coordinate and collaborate on local events, and seeking information for technological advancement of City Hall. To fulfill our mission, the Promotion and Tourism Advisory Board was allocated $20,000 to be used during 2015. As of yet, these funds have not been used. In September, Debbie Code responded to an inquiry from our board concerning the possibility of these funds being rolled over to 2016. Her response was, "Funds from 2015 cannot be rolled over to 2016 without a valid encumbrance. This means you must have a valid vendor requisition and purchase order processed by purchasing to hold any 2015 funds. You cannot encumber funds for the sake of holding them. Rule of thumb is that goods be received during the first 90 days of the new year. All encumbrances at year end are reviewed during our pre-audit. Those that do not meet the standard will be released to fund balance." And she added, "There is no budget for this advisory board in the 2016 budget." I have been working with Mayor Gillen, Justin Rudgick, and Nate Emmons as to how to allocate these funds. As of yet, a decision has not been made. I will be meeting with Mayor-elect Billy Barlow at the end of this month concerning these funds, as well as the continuation of the board. With all of that being said, I'm requesting that the funds that were allocated for the Promotion and Tourism Advisory Board remain in place until a decision has been made on the allocation of such. Thank you for your consideration of this matter.
Thank you, Ellen. Appreciate your comments. Frank, you want to come up now, man?
My name is Frank Timpson from Ontario Taxi. You all well know, just pointed out to me that I've been coming here for 9 years about the taxi cab, illegal drivers, illegal taxis, sexual offenders, drug abusers, what have you. Last month, I had $77,500 worth of damage done to my property and my house. They vandalized my van, transmission, stole all my paperwork, took $280 in cash, all my Social Security cards and everything else. And that wasn't enough for them. They decided to go to the old lady's house next door and they trashed her vehicle. And then they didn't have enough of that, so they decided to total her son's car. Why? Because I was working with the Department of Justice and the Federal Department of Transportation up in Buffalo, and Al Chase, Lee Walker, and I'm pretty sure Lake City Taxi got subpoenas or something to that effect, that they're going to be subpoenaed for the overloading and all the illegal activities that goes on here in the city. I talked to Mrs. I got her name written down at home, the lady up in DOT, and she told me it was referred to the regional office here in Syracuse, which we all know don't do nothing. They inspect the buses and everything else. The overloading is just sick, crazy mad. Your brother was overloading so bad this weekend, I'm looking for him. That's how mad I am. Okay? And as far as these taxis, you got Sonny's taxi over there picking up in his mother's vehicle with his brother, who is a convicted sex offender. These people move drugs. They're moving drugs right now, 151 East 3rd. There is heroin there. There is cocaine there. I made a report to the police department. They don't give a shit. They don't give a crap about nothing. They have a full print on glasses and full prints for the other prints for all the vandalism done at my house. No arrests have been made. I'm the guy who got the black guy last Thursday in my cab, put my life at risk, helping the cops apprehend somebody that had a knife to some girl's throat for 4 hours, and I'm a concerned citizen. That's what your paper reported in the news and everything else. I'm done with this crap. I'm asking you, are you going to step up to the plate? You already gave me one Christmas present this year. I don't know if you're aware. Mrs. Gay Williams has history, and I break into my happy dance every time I think about that. And all I can say is, it's a great day in Bethlehem. And hip hip for Billy. Hip hip for at last. Hip hip Billy. Kick some frickin' ass, will ya? Give it up.
Mr. Timpson, please. Show some respect for this committee and this organization. You will be quiet. You will be quiet. Or we'll have you escorted from this building.
I don't need to be escorted. I am leaving. I said my piece. But I'm going to start a war, and you guys will never forget.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Timpson. I apologize for his behavior. The next speaker.
Please,
sir. Thank you, officer.
All right, enough.
Friends of my child, I am a Christmas of Thursday. I think the ran of them. 2 years ago, there are elected officials. These honest people in here. They're not here for one. He's walking out the door.
Dave, you ready? Dave White, you're next.
Well, I want a tree down.
Well, no dancing. You'll break a hip at your age.
I do like his haircut, though. Obviously, he was upset. I'm just wondering if within the next 10 days I could get a Christmas present. If that tree... That has been ruining my life, I guess, for the last, I can't tell you how long. I want to thank Franny for all his help on this, which is frustrating to him. I harassed Pat when I see him at the bagel shop. We have 10 days. They did come and take down the little one. My wife was happy about that. They went up the other tree, and lo and behold, they come back down. Now, I don't know if these squirrels are playing the bed tax or not, but I would appreciate it if you could take that tree down.
Dave, I'm not familiar. Is this in front of your house?
This is on the side of my driveway. The tree is dead. We've been looking at this tree. How long, Franny? In fact, he's offered today. Him and I may end up doing this. I don't. He's got a chainsaw. So.
I'll talk.
But DPW. I would appreciate it.
Sure.
Well, thank you.
Dead lady, or is it old, just like you?
Maybe that cop will escort me out. I'm not sure about that other guy.
See what we can do, Dave. Happy holidays, man. Next speaker is Justin Rudzik. Rudzik.
Justin.
I don't know how I can follow up to some of those events, but anyways, I just want to say good evening, Mayor Gillen and members of the Common Council. I'd like to take this opportunity as the 2015 year come to close to thank you for your support in my efforts to lead the Community Development Office. I thank you for your support in recognizing that the Community Development Office plays an integral role in creating economic and development opportunities for the city of Oswego. As you know, the office has been mired in controversy, mismanagement, lack of leadership that has spanned many years. Under a new direction and leadership, the Community Development Office has made significant improvements in the last 6 months. In the past 6 months, the Community Development Office has been awarded, reinstated, and initiated grant funding opportunities in the amount of $2,966,250, or just shy of $3 million within the last 6 months. $400,000 of that was for housing rehab, $300,000 for home ownership, $34,500 for family self-sufficiency, $1.5 million was reinstated as part of the Oswego Harbor Revitalization Initiative. $132,250 was just recently awarded for the waterfront feasibility study. $600,000 was recently awarded for public infrastructure as part of the West Side Wastewater Sewer Rehab Project. These projects will be kicked off in the year of 2016, and I'm looking forward to continuing this momentum and building on the success with the new administration and the council. I look forward to working with Mayor-elect Barlow, Councilor Caitlin Reynolds, Councilor Pat McLaughlin, Councilor Nate Emmon, Councilor Sean Walker, Councilor John Gozick, Councilor Van Buren, and Councilor Robert Corradino. Most importantly, I want to thank Councilor Kapowitz, Councilor Todd, and Councilor Enright for their support as they leave the council this year. The Community Development Office wishes everyone a Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Justin. And I will have some comments about Justin in the mayor's report. He's done a remarkable job for the community, so you'll get your holiday recognition pretty soon. Is there anybody else here who'd like to make any comments? Mr. Becker, sir.
As far as that community development program, the proof is in the pudding. You're doing a wonderful job. Tom, I'm going to miss you up there. You've always been kind to me, more than I can say for the mayor before you. I wish you all a Merry Christmas, too. I wish you all the luck in the world, Bill. I hope you got that magic wand greased up. Or is that the holy water? Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Miles. It's been a pleasure working with you for the last 4 years. Happy holidays, brother. Is there anybody else who would like to make any comments or holiday wishes? Okay, well, having said that, I will adjourn the public session. The regular meeting will begin at 7:30. Thank you. So please take their seats. All right, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Will the clerk please call the roll?
His Honor, the Mayor.
Here.
Councilor Enright.
Here.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Here.
Councilor Todd. Councilor Walker.
Here.
Councilor Barlow.
Here.
Councilor Van Buren.
Oh, he is excused.
Councilor Kapowitz.
Here.
We have six present with one excused.
Thank you. As everyone probably knows, it's kind words from Miles and a lot of other people. This is my last official meeting. We may have to have an emergency meeting sometime between now and the end of the year, but hopefully not. So this would be the last meeting that I will have the pleasure of overseeing. And I do want to make a few comments. For the 4 years and for this council and these workers at City Hall in particular. First of all, I'd like to thank everybody for the honor of a lifetime. You can only imagine what it's like to be the mayor of a city. It's a lot of responsibility, but with it comes a lot of joy, a lot of heartache. It's a cultural change. Not having served in the council, never been in elected office before, I worked in technology. I worked for Apple and I worked for AT&T Bell Laboratories. And my business was designing data networks. And so this was a learning experience for me, and I appreciate your patience as I went through the four years of this. There are some highlights. I've been criticized because I don't talk enough about all the wonderful things we've accomplished as an administration. And that's what I want to talk about. It's not what I did. It's what we did. And you folks who sit out there, what you did too. And that's what makes the city in the position we are right now. So I want to give you an update on some of the things that, from working together, what we can do and what's happening and what's going to happen. The consent decree, which is everybody's topic. We're going to talk about it again tonight. The first phase is complete. We did this. We separated the sewers in parts of the 7th, a little bit of the 5th ward. The next leg is going to start next year, where we're going to be separating the sewers in the 5th part of the 3rd. Going to be a nightmare. We're going to be digging up these old streets. People are going to be inconvenienced. It's going to be tough getting around. There's going to be holes in construction sites. And I'd ask for your patience and understanding that we don't have a choice in this matter. We've been told to do this by the DEC and the EPA. We're working diligently. Ron Kaplowitz and I have been down to Albany to meet with the commissioner of the DEC. We've met with EPA representatives to renegotiate this. We're making progress, but they do say one project is not enough. If you do the second project, we might reconsider renegotiation. We dug a hole pretty deep. We refused to talk to these folks. We kind of fought and we pushed back, said we weren't going to do it. Well, we did it, and we have to do it. So I want to wish Mayor Lick Barlow success in managing. It's going to be a challenging time for us all. But we're on schedule. We're working with the DEC. We're working with the EPA. We do have friends. I was with Ken Lynch, the director of the DEC, regional director, yesterday. And he's prepared to work with us. So there's good news ahead of us on that. The other thing is one thing that we did accomplish was the tracking account. Another thing that people don't seem to know, but back in the day, we negotiated a contract with Niagara Mohawk at the time where they paid us a certain amount of money for the energy that we produced. And everyone thought the energy curve was going to keep going up and up and up, but in fact, it actually went down and down and down. So they've been overpaying us for years. We renegotiated. Had we not done this, there would have come a time when the people of Oswego would have been looking down the wrong end of a barrel of a $38 million bill that we would have to pay. We did this. It's a little unheralded, nobody knows about it, but we saved the city an awful lot of time, money, and aggravation. Brookfield, everybody remembers the end of the world scenarios of the sirens, the warning signs, get out of the river, the end of the world's coming. We renegotiated that with Brookfield, and it's such a productive, positive relationship with them now that they've actually invested in the riverway. They're actually funding river stewards. Going to help people find better places to fish, educate them on it. It was a good place to get a decent meal around it. So they're part of the team. So that's the Brookfield problem. Became our enemy, became our friend again. We restructured our fire department and our ambulance service. We looked at it and we found out that we had too many ambulances. We were supporting the entire county at our expense. You folks were subsidizing the ambulance service for the entire county of Oswego. We now only support county, go to a private carrier. So we've saved an incredible amount of money. We restructured it. We're down to two ambulances. Different kind of ambulances, not the big ones. We actually generate positive net profit out of these. They actually, there is overtime that goes to the fire department, which we're going to be working with thanks to the councilors here. But we do make money, which impacts the positive side, city accounting. Justin talked about reorganizing community development. We did that. And I think it speaks volumes of what we've accomplished just in the 7 months that he's been here, is the fact that we've seen all this infusion of grant money, new opportunities, applications, development. He's been a great resource to us, and we look forward to a long and fruitful relationship with Justin and his team. The Holiday Inn and Express, Midtown Plaza litigation, it was in all the papers for years. Those have all been resolved. You can see the Holiday Inn, it's looming over the horizon there now, and it should be open in the spring. The Midtown Plaza, we've got a developer who's going to be redeveloping that for market rate housing, not affordable housing, market rate, and commercial development office space. It's going to be the center point of the redevelopment of the east side of downtown. The Cahill Building, litigation negotiation there has been resolved. We'll see that thing survive and flourish. The 104 Corridor Initiation, this is something Amy Birdsell was working on, designing a new design for our city corridor. Come into 104 on the east and west sides. Right now, it's kind of horrible. We've got funding to do a feasibility study and a design to improve the entire corridor downtown, which is going to create a whole new quality of life for our community. And you're going to be seeing that in the next year. City campus relationship. It's a true partnership. 4 years ago, we had a bad relationship with the campus would have been good. We have a great relationship with them now. In fact, the parties, the buses, we don't get the complaints that we get before. We have taken action with the police department. We have really done a remarkable job, whether it's foot patrols, positive reinforcement of the laws. We have changed the city relationship. We are a college town. It doesn't mean anything goes. That means these kids and their parents are welcome here, and they've come here. And we've seen the benefits from that. I talked about the police. Drug control. We had a lot of drug arrests, meth labs. It's terrible. We've cleaned them up. The message is out there right now. The city of Oswego is not a place to come if you want to make drugs or sell drugs. We still have them. We're a college town, but we're not the place that we were. We've re-energized our downtown, the Oswego Renaissance Association. 4 years ago, we sat down with most of these gentlemen in the room right now sat down with CZB. We talked about how do we make the city stabilize? How do we reinvest in our neighborhoods? We did that. The Oswego Renaissance Association came into being at that point in time, and it's flourished. And we expect them to continue to develop particularly our historic parts of downtown and our classic neighborhoods. We've re-energized downtown. Try to find a place to park downtown on a weekend now. It's getting, it's really difficult because people come here now. I talk to people, they say, well, Oswego is not the Oswego I remember. It's a vibrant, exciting place to be, and it's only going to get better. And we've got new leadership coming in who's going to add a new dimension to this, about youthful activities. So I'm pretty excited about that. We've re-energized our parks. We've reinvested in them. We've put in playground equipment. We've invested in plantings. We've repaired Montcalm Park through Councilor Enright's efforts. We've brought back the classic parks of our neighborhood. We're very lucky. We have so much historic property here. We have these huge old parks. We have a walking downtown. We're very fortunate, and we've preserved it, and we're investing in it again. Good news on the horizon with the national park status for Ontario and the Safe Haven Refugee Center. It's being spearheaded by Congressman Katko and Hannah. It's getting a lot of attention. I was with Congressman Katko yesterday. We were talking about that, and he feels very strongly that this is something that will happen in the next few years, and it's going to be a great asset to our community. It's a privilege of who we are with our Safe Haven Refuge Museum, the only city that opened its doors to the Holocaust victims. It says a lot about who we are as a people. The Great Lakes Marine Sanctuary application. Looking very positive at that. Reed Boney, the regional director for NOAA, has been visiting us for several years now talking to us. In fact, he recruited this city to be the candidate. So we've been in the process of working collaboratively with the county of Oswego, which is a great thing for the city, as well as Wayne, Jefferson, and Cayuga County. So with that, when that happens, I firmly believe we're going to win this. That's going to drive so much revenue and tourism to our city between the national park status, the fort, and the Safe Haven Harbor. What we're going to see is in the Marine Sanctuary in Alpena, which is up in Thunder Bay, it's a city half our size. This is a city that was in steady decline. They put in a Marine Sanctuary there. Last year alone, they drove $17 million in sales tax. We do over 15 here. We're twice the size. So what that the impact that's going to have on our city is going to be very dramatic, very positive. We do have some challenges, though, and the historic buildings we have, the library, the city library, which we improved. City Hall, this is going to need some work. Billy's going to be working on this one. This, we have to preserve this. But working with Justin's organization, hopefully we'll be able to get the funding to do that. The other thing I want to talk about is the Upstate Revitalization Initiative Award. The reason I went to meet with the governor yesterday was because of that. Central New York, obviously, is one of the winners. $500 million in Central New York. That means $100 million a year for the next 5 years. And a good chunk of that is going to be coming to our city. And that's because we are a bright focal point in the future of Central New York. What we do here in the city is going to have a positive impact throughout the county, throughout Central New York in general. And Governor Cuomo realizes that. So it was a real pleasure to be with him and to see this. It's actually going to happen. We did do things, though, that weren't popular. We raised taxes. A couple years ago, we raised taxes a lot, 42.5%. The year before that, I think it was 14%. The reason we did that was because it needed to be done. We realized it was political suicide. That's why I'm probably not going to be the mayor. I'm not the mayor anymore. But we did it as a team. We voted for it, Republicans and Democrats alike, because it was the best interest of the city in mind. And because of that, after a decade of flat taxes, dwindling revenue, not investing in our city, we start to see the deterioration of our city. So we stopped that. It was painful. It was difficult. It took a lot of courage. And a lot of these councilors that are here right now voted for that. It wasn't a pleasant event. And I remember with Ron and everybody that remembers it, it was probably the worst part of my life, literally. I can think of very few things that were worse than those meetings and what we had to go through. But we did it. And because we did it, we turned the city around. And we got it back on a path. Our sales tax revenue has increased significantly. our assessed property values up. People are reinvesting in homes. The crime rate is down. It's down significantly, thanks to the police department. People are investing, people are moving to the city, and it's a positive trend. We're off the list of distressed cities. We're not like Fulton, Syracuse, all these other cities that are in trouble. We're off that list. Our bond rating has improved, so now when we have to borrow money to do internal development and repairs, we can borrow money at a better rate. We've rebuilt our fund balance. Previous administrations have just kept draining money. It's like cash in your 401k. Well, we rebuilt that. Working with Chamberlain's office, we're adding millions of dollars back to that, just in case something happens. We were self-insured. Now we've gone through NYMRA, which is a state organization that they do our insurance. So we're not liable. If someone gets hurt in a serious fall, it could bankrupt the city. That's not going to happen. So we did change that. Our quality of life is up. Just look at the festivals. My goodness, every weekend there's something going on. I'm exhausted from going to all these fundraisers, festivals, and celebrate the city. It's a wonderful thing. Our home sales are up. People are moving in here. Population's up. We're tracking in a very good way. So I just wanted to make sure that people understood that the last 4 years has not been just sitting around wondering how we're going to raise taxes. There was a reason for it. Some of us paid the price for it. It was worth it. I'll tell you that right now. It was worth it. I was born and raised in the city. My grandfather, I live in the house my great-grandfather built. I came back here because I wanted to raise my kids here, and I did, and they all turned out great. And I love this city, and the best thing I did was run for office, and if I can change the city through your help and through these gentlemen here, I'm delighted to have done that. And I do want to recognize the people who do this. I'm just the mayor. I'm the CEO. The real corporation is the people on the board of directors here and the people who work for the company. And that's our city employees. I want to recognize some of these people. I'm going to save the councils for the last because those are the most interesting ones. But I want to thank our department heads. And Chief McCroby from the fire department. There's a guy who's gone through more criticism, stress, and aggravation than anybody I've ever met in my life. He has been flexible and dedicated. And he has done what so many people thought could never be done. He's turning the fire department around into a profitable organization. He's done a remarkable job. He's done everything we've asked him to do. He provides safety and leadership, and he's been not only just a great leader, but a great friend. So I want to applaud Jeff for that. Chief, I don't believe he's here, but there's another one. When you look up professional in the dictionary, you'll see a picture of Tory Decure there. This man is probably the finest officer you'll ever see. Yeah, he's just wonderful, and he's done great things. I hope we can keep him a long time here before he gets lured away by Syracuse and all those things. DPW Commissioner Mike Smith, you're not going to get off that easy, Mike. There's the toughest job in town. The man who has to deal with potholes, water main breaks, you name it, leaves, parking, everything falls under his control. Underpaid, overworked, and he's only 23 years old. I mean, look at the guy. It's amazing. Mike, you're the best. He's retiring this year, and he will be missed. And I'm proud to call him my friend. And, it was a joy getting to know him, and anything this man wants, he's the best. Sitting next to him is Deb, our chamberlain, the wizard of the accounts. She is the brains of our finances. They're all underpaid for the most part. I don't know what we'd do without Debbie. She's been just wonderful. She's brilliant, and she's hardworking, and she's dedicated. I don't know anybody loves the city more than she does. Rita Tickle, there's another. Talk about it. Life in the trenches. Rita has to deal with all the personnel issues, not just for the city, but the school district, the Board of Oswego.
Underpaid.
Very good, Miles. And I also, I can't not mention our city and interest. Without them, I don't know what I would do because they keep these meetings on schedule and they keep everything professional. I still don't know Robert's Rules of Order. I still struggle with this whole thing. It's not comfortable with me. It's challenging, so I want to thank them for all they do.
Underpaid.
Thank you. Community development, I think I said some nice things about you already, Justin, but they're very heartfelt and sincere. I look forward to a very, very long relationship. I've got to mention our city attorney, Gay and Tom, Gay Williams and Tom Reynolds, first class, the consummate professionals. We're lucky to have them. And they work part-time. It's a full-time job, a part-time thing. Thanks, Tom. Thanks, Gay. Gay's tough, but I wish she was here to hear this. We went through the engineering reorganization. We lost Tony Leota. Bob Johnson has been here. He's done a yeoman's job. He's taken up the challenge, and he's held that department together. First-class guy. We're working right now with an outside contractor for engineering services. That's part of the transition of a modern city. Sue Deary. She's not here tonight, but she is our assessor. She's been working in codes. She's one tough, smart woman. She's dedicated to the city. I want to thank her for all her efforts as well. Mike Riley's not here. He's our contract specialist. He's been in purchasing forever. I don't know what we'd do without Mike. Our water plant manager, Brian Fulgrate, he's been running the water plant for quite a while. He's done a remarkably good job. Gary Hallinan, our wastewater. We've been talking about our solution to our wastewater crisis right now, but Gary's done a phenomenal job. Carrie Anderson from the Animal Control. She works 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. Doing something that we've never had anybody do before. That's really build up that shelter and take care of the animals in our community. Brian Chetney with the Youth Bureau, remarkable job. The connection to the county and what we're doing. Zoning and planning with Amy Birdsall, bringing organization and structure into the city. Someone with a vision and a plan who says, this is what we are now, this is where we hope to be, this is how we're going to get there. Mike Bonney, IT guy. Never had an IT guy. So glad he's here because he's made everything happen with microphones and TVs. We used to do things with a camera and a TV once or twice a week, if you could even see it. And, of course, the custodians that actually keep this place going. I want to thank them all, and they've done a remarkable job. I take my hat off. Running a city, unless you've sat here, the mayor's office, understand that you're responsible for everything. Pick up that gum wrapper in life, responsibility. It's the people that you count on. So we've got good people. We don't have enough of them. We've gone through attrition to the point where look around some of these people who work for us. They look like me. They look gray. And they're going to be retiring soon. We need to get young people. We need to start building up this city because we're in a growth mode. We need new energy to accommodate the new future. So that's my thank you to the people. I got to say hello to say thanks to these guys that I have worked with. I came in here cold. I'd never held public office before. I never even came to the City Hall meeting. I just decided that I was going to run for office because I thought I could. I love the city. I think I could make a difference. Hopefully I did. But I couldn't have done anything without these gentlemen. And I'm just going to go around and recognize what they've done. Fran Enright. I mean, Fran, I've known him and his family since I was a little kid. We grew up in the old St. John's neighborhood. We went to Catholic High. He has the same background I do. I know his mom. Brother Leo and his sister Seal. It's old neighborhood. He's a friend. And what else about him that's remarkable? Very analytical. He understands these complex, almost annoyingly analytical, I might add, because he can go through all these spreadsheets and things like that, and he can boil it down into a good business proposal. He's been a real asset to the community. He's helped us out a lot. I want to thank Fran for everything he's done. And then I go over to Pat, my new friend, Pat McLaughlin. And the thing I like about Pat is that he got reelected, so he did something very positive. But he's the walking man. You can see him downtown Oswego. He's everywhere. He shows up for every meeting. I've never seen anybody who really captures a love affair with the city as he does. Retired from the DPW, so he understands how these things work. He's a kind, generous man, and he's a smart guy. So I think he's a real asset. And Pat, a new friend of mine, and I thank you for being part of our future. We replaced Mike Myers with someone else I grew to know very well. And Mike spent a lot of years here, and I want to reach out to Mike and say he did a wonderful job, too. He's a good friend as well. Mike Todd, I don't know what to say. He doesn't want me to say anything, and I, of course, then I'm going to have to. I have to tell you, when I first took this job, I thought, I'm never going to get along with this guy. I just can't. We're just going to have a blow out here. He's a great guy. He's probably a someone I consider a close, dear friend. We disagree constantly. We have fights. We'd be like, but it's like family. You know, like my family at Thanksgiving dinner. You know, we still love each other, but we like to argue a lot. So Mike, his heart is in the right place. His head, sometimes, I don't know. I disagree with that. But I love the guy, and I'm going to miss him. He's going to be a friend forever. We're going to go golfing. Right, Mike? I've said enough good things about you, so that's it. I know your love for the city is sincere. Billy, well, you're going to decide for Billy. He's a brilliant young man. He's going to lead the city. I'm here to serve anything he needs. He's elected by the people, and he's going to do a solid job. So he's got my support, and hopefully the support of the council. And I know if you ever need me, Billy, you can count on me. Congratulations, and good luck. It's going to be a challenge, but I think you're the right guy to do it. He did replace Danny Donovan, another one of our old guys from St. John's. Danny was a great guy. Served the Fifth Ward for many, many years. I grew to know him very well as well. He's the one who actually turned around the Holiday Inn. I know a lot of people feel bad about that. Somehow that was an invasion of their life, their location. But it's good for the community. We really need that. Then we get to Eric Van Buren. Unfortunately, he's not here, and I hope it's all right. His wife is like 8 months pregnant. He's in Syracuse in the hospital. I guess there's some complications, so we have prayers with him. And my memories of Eric were meeting him for the first time. He was like a 19-year-old kid, and he was running for council. And we became good friends, and now he's president of the council. So he's a special man. And last but not least, and certainly not least, is Ron Kaplowitz. And I'll tell you, I couldn't have done half this stuff, maybe none of it, without that man right there. Ron Kaplowitz, when I started, they said, you'll never get anything done. I'm a Democrat. Two Democrats, 5 Republicans, and you'll never get anything done. Ron and I sat down and we worked it out. This was an O'Neill-Reagan relationship. First time we got together, we went off to Albany to meet with the DEC, negotiate how we were going to get through this consent decree. And we've been doing it nonstop. We've taken every sacred cow on. We've challenged every unsurmountable object. We've done it. We've taken on the tracking account, consent decree. This team, we've done it. And this was the leader. This was the council president that I counted on. And he never, ever let me down. And so I consider him, respect him for his dedication, his intelligence, and he's a close friend. I look forward to a long friendship with him. So that's basically all I have to say. That's kind of like my farewell and my schmoozing for everybody that I've worked with. But I just want to thank you. It has been the worst 4 years of my life and the best 4 years of my life. I've made some great friends. And we've accomplished some wonderful things. And momentum is there for Billy. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I skip you, Sean? No, I'm saving Sean for last. Because Sean and I have a special thing about Sean. First of all, he's changed. He's half the man he was when I first met him. And you know what I mean. He was a large man at one time. He went and became a different person. And he also went through probably one of the most challenging things I've ever seen. And that was his daughter, Michaela. He was very ill. And I think that's love, dedication, and professionalism. And that's the man that I have a lot of respect for. He works hard for a living. He works for the county. He works for a living. What he had to go through as a parent is something that all of us who have kids would never want to go through. I understand she's recovering, she's fine. That's the best news I could ever do. So I wanted to end it on a positive note. That's what this city is all about. That's what these people are about. Don't believe the stuff you hear in The Lion and all that other nonsense. These are people who are here because the pay's lousy, the hours stink, and all you do is get aggravation and complaints. But look what we've accomplished. I just want everybody to give these gentlemen a round of applause. So please, join me in. All right.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for that. All right, I guess that's it for me. I'm going to shut up now, and I'm going to let the councilors make any comments they have, and we'll get on with it. Okay, I guess we've got some people. Shall we start here with Councilor Enright?
Well, that's a tough act to follow, but I do want to thank everyone I've worked with here. First of all, my wife has come tonight, and It's a challenge for us, as everybody knows, trying to do the job, but it's just as challenging at home for our wives and loved ones that watch us go through some of the things we have to do when it came to raising taxes or some of the really tough decisions. They go through it too. They go through it on the streets. They go through it with the friends of ours that come in and talk about it. And if anything, it's tougher on them because they can never vote on the issue. So I want to thank my wife, Diane, who came here. I also want to thank the folks at City Hall. I mean, the mayor mentioned that before, and they're phenomenal. When you first come in here as a freshman, you really don't know where to start. I start with the money lady down here. I figure we'll go right with the purse strings first thing. And Deborah Cote was fantastic and got us going, got me going in the right direction. Our city attorneys were wonderful, and everyone else that we mentioned before, Mike Riley, our girls at the clerk's office, and the fire chief, the police department, and Rita Tickle with personnel. Justin Amboard down here has been great. So I really appreciate everything, all the cooperation. And lastly, I want to thank all of my constituents in the first ward in the office for two terms. And I really appreciate the citizens that show up here on every meeting and show our support, show the concerns, whether or not they agree with us. But I know that they're concerned, and that's the reason why I'm here. I'm here to represent you, and I really appreciate you giving me that chance to do that. It's an experience I'll never, ever forget. Thank you.
Any other comments? Yes, Mike.
I think I'd want to start out, I'm not sure where to start, but I think the most important thing to start out by saying is thank you to the constituents of my ward that elected me twice to serve them. It was a real honor. Nate's going to be replacing me. I know he's going to be coming in, and Nate will do a really good job for us. Anxious to see him get started. I think there's a lot of positive stuff he can do. I also want to thank the workers here in the city of Oswego. I don't think people realize just how good the employees we have here in the city of Oswego are. Our department heads have been excellent. I've had a really good working relationship with one of them. Jeff and I, you know, known each other a long time, and we've had our moments, but Jeff, Mayor said it probably the best. I mean, Jeff really has done an awful lot with what he's been asked to deal with. Mike Smith, congratulations, Mike, on your retirement. Thank you for all your help. Rita, you're free of me. You don't have to listen to my phone calls anymore. And you too, Deb. You don't have to deal with me anymore. But we really do have some great city employees here who really do try. And as Miles said, most of them really are underpaid for what they have to deal with and what they do. I also want to thank Tom. I know he's gotten a lot of criticism over the years for stuff in a lot of cases that he really had no control over. But for anybody that's worked with Tom, who's ever had to go in and deal with him, and we've certainly had our moments where we've had some disagreements. But Tom genuinely cares about this city. He's one of the nicest men I've ever met, and he really does try. And a lot of the criticism he's got really isn't been warranted. But the guys here on the council, I know in past years before we got on here, there really was this reputation that the council really didn't do a whole lot. They just argued and fighting and fought with each other. And I think that's probably the thing that I've been most proud of here on the council, that even when we disagreed in executive session or we got in screaming matches on the phone, Ron, that we tried to act professionally out here. For the most part, we've had our disagreements, but we really haven't let politics separate what we tried to do if it was right for the city. Sean, Billy, Pat, Fran, we've all had our disagreements. But these guys have all tried to work together and kind of change the culture here on this council floor. And it really is the thing I'm most proud of, and I hope the next incoming council, and I wish you guys all the luck in the world. You guys really have a lot on your plate coming forward. You're going to have difficult choices, just as we did. But I really hope you guys work together and try and solve those. Billy, I wish you all the luck. You deserve this. You're going to be good at it. It's going to be difficult. And I really hope you guys all work together. You've got some really good guys in women coming onto the council. Some very smart people. I think they've got a lot to offer. I think there's a lot that they can do to help the city. And I really wish you all a lot of luck. And if there's anything any of us can do to help you, to give you a historical perspective on why something was done, I'm more than happy. I'm sure anybody here on the council floor would be more than happy to do that. I think that's pretty much it. But I really wanted to thank everybody. It really was a pleasure being on the council. And thank you to everybody that helped with that.
Any other comments from the council? Councilor Barlow.
Thank you, Mayor. And first, I'd like to thank you and the department heads under you. The transition has been, the departments have been very cooperative. You've personally been very cooperative, and I appreciate you taking the time to meet with me today and the Monday after Election Day to kind of set the stage for what I'm walking into. And thank again all the department heads who have really worked with my incoming department heads to make sure that we hit the ground running on January 1st. I'd also like to thank the 5th Ward residents who elected me 2 years ago, and I appreciate their support through this last campaign. And then Councilor-elect John Gozick's in the crowd. He's going to be taking over for the 5th Ward, and I'd just like to congratulate him, and I look forward to working with you, John, so good luck.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Thank you, Your Honor. Without sounding like I'm going to parrot what everyone else has said, because I think everyone has been very eloquent. Their sincerity and with the sincerity and truly the love for the city, which I think we've all shared for many, many years. I do believe that in the end we have as a team left our city better than we found it. And that's all you can hope. Some may argue. Overall, at the tough decisions that we had to make, and they were tough decisions, I do believe in the end we are leaving it better than we found it. And I also believe we're leaving it in very good hands. We have an uncommon, energetic, he's older beyond his years, and I really do believe he's the real deal. And I think we're lucky to have Barlow step to the plate, and all the new counselors that will also find the challenges that it's nice to sit out there when you finally have to get in here and express your sentiments, whatever it may be. There will be those that will agree and those that will disagree, no matter what you do. And that's kind of the way of life sitting up on this side of the aisle. To the mayor, he is a dear friend. He is, Michael Todd said, he's the nicest man I know. And there were times we didn't agree on things and direction, but in the end, none of that mattered. It was what was ultimately what was best for our city. And I think each and every one of us truly felt that whatever decision we were making was not self-serving. It was truly in the best interest of our city. Those fellow counselors, Fran and Mike Todd, and I can remember some discussions we had. I remember one that got rather personal out here. And folks were just amazed that Mike and I could go play golf the next day after the kind of discussions we had here. We had a great passion for what we did. And we appreciated and respected each other's opinions. We listened to what were our options and what were our opportunities. We weren't married to ideas. Tell us why it's best for the city. I think in the end, we did that. I go back to that 42.5% tax increase, and you know what? It was the most unpopular thing we could have ever done in the city. Absolutely the most unpopular. I mean, I went home sick of my But in the end, it was the best. And you know what? It was a unanimous vote by the council. To those who understood and to those individuals that came to our meetings time again understand the intricacies of the budget. I think they came to appreciate just how hard some of those decisions were. And they really were hard decisions. Fran and Michael, all of my friends, Mayor, City of West for Life, as with the rest. To fellow councilors Van Buren, Walker, Laughlin, fresh ideas and fresh energies and hopefully a whole another way of looking at things. And I think that's important in transition to corporate government. That couldn't be there forever. Plant your ideas, plant your seeds, and then let others come in and see if they can nurture the crop. And I believe that's what we're doing. To Jeannie, to Sally, department heads, to all the city employees, I love you guys. Greatest employees that we can imagine. We have some soft spots, probably do. We take a care of a few of them. But we have some folks that really care about them. They don't care how many hours they work, they don't care what they do their job and they do it well. We're very, very lucky. Very lucky. Most importantly, I do want to thank the residents of the 7th Ward for giving me a chance to serve them and this city. It's been a great honor. And Bobby Cordino's that honor next, and it is a great honor. It's a great responsibility, and I know how seriously you will take that. I'll just close by saying that, you know what? You have many moments in life, and this 6 years is but a moment, but it will be a lifetime memory, and I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. How about this thing? Come on, Sean. What do you got?
Wow, these are hard acts to follow. It's supposed to be a short meeting. But I just like to have a special thanks for Mayor Gillen, Councilor Enright, Councilor Todd, Councilor Kapowitz, for your dedicated time and service. A lot of time in there. Your knowledge, we needed that. We did need it. And I'm going to be seeing pretty much everybody else here for the next 2 years. This is going to be my last term. City. And everybody else, I'd like to wish happy holidays and best of future for everybody here.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. How about that?
First off, I'd like to thank the mayor and the three counselors that are leaving for everything you've taught me. It's not easy to teach me, so. And I'm looking forward to working with Mayor-elect Barlow and the new counselors in the future. That's all I've got to say.
Well, Sean, you're going to be the senior spokesman. Well done. Hopefully, you'll share some of your experiences, the positive ones, anyway.
Yes.
With the next generation. So I think we've shared enough nostalgia and schmaltz with everybody. But I really, it's sincere. I think the takeaway from this is that this is an uncommon council. And that's the way I'd like to remember it. So if there's nothing else, any other comments from anyone on the council or anyone else, I guess could we possibly go into the business, and would you please call Resolution 479?
Resolution 479 would approve the minutes of the common council meeting held November 23rd, 2015.
Councilor Kapowitz, Councilor Enright, any discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Councilor Kapowitz?
Yes.
Councilor Enright?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd?
Yes.
Councilor Walker?
Yes.
Councilor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 480.
Resolution 480 would approve the use of public space at the request of Oswego Sub Shop located at 106 West Bridge Street in order to place signs.
Councilor Todd? Councilor Barlow? Any discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Councilor Kapowitz?
Yes.
Councilor Enright?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd?
Yes.
Councilor Walker?
Yes.
Councilor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 481.
Resolution 481 would approve the use of public space at the request of Trinity Catholic School in order to place advertising signs.
Councilor Walker and Councilor McLaughlin, any discussion? Seeing none, please call the roll.
Councilor Kapowitz?
Yes.
Councilor Enright?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd?
Yes.
Councilor Walker?
Yes.
Councilor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 482.
Resolution 482 would approve installation of a closed circuit camera system at the Christopher Lee Ice Rink by the Oswego Minor Hockey Association.
Councilor McLaughlin? Councilor Kapowitz? Is there any discussion? Please call the roll.
Councilor Kapowitz?
Yes.
Councilor Enright?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd? Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 483.
Resolution 483 would authorize the mayor to execute an extension of the lease agreement with Wayne Drugs for property located at 24 through 26 West Cuba Street.
Counselor Enright, Counselor Kaplowitz. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Abstain due to a close personal relationship with the owner.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 5-0-2.
Please call Resolution 484.
Resolution 584 would authorize the mayor to execute a one-year renewal agreement with the County of Oswego for weights and measures services for the year 2016.
Counselor Walker, Counselor McLaughlin. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 485.
Resolution 485 would approve the City of Oswego Section 504 Grievance Policy and Procedure Plan.
Counselor Enright and Counselor Todd. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 486.
Resolution 486 would approve a transfer of funds from within the fire department.
Counselor McLaughlin and Counselor Enright. Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Stay the course, Jeff. Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 487.
Resolution 487 would waive the rules of the common council to present resolutions number 488 through 490 from the floor without committee consideration.
Counselor Kaplowitz? Counselor McLaughlin. Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 488.
Resolution 488 would authorize the mayor to execute an agreement with Camden Group Incorporated to provide consulting and staffing support services for the wastewater treatment facilities.
Counselor Kaplowitz, Counselor McLaughlin. Is there any discussion? Counselor Kaplowitz.
Yes, Your Honor, I just will make a brief statement on this and just congratulate you and the council for putting this in place. This is actually for those who may look at this and say, what are we doing here? This is a step toward privatization, and I think it's a very, very important one for this city. And not that we're looking to fire folks or get, you know, put people out of work. That's not the case at all. But I think there's opportunities for us to create greater economies within our budget and through privatization. That certainly is an option, and I know that we've explored literally.
Any other comments? None. Please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 489.
Resolution 489 would authorize the mayor to enter into a revised five-year lease agreement with the Ontario Center for the Performing Arts for the use of the McCrovey Building for the years 2016 through 2020.
Enright, second Councilor McLaughlin. Any discussion? Councilor Enright.
Yeah, I just wanted to, I see that Mark Wall from the Ontario Center for Performing Arts is here, and I just wanted to thank him for, I believe it's been 29 years that I know of that they've been down, our tenants down at the McCrovey Building putting on performances and have evolved into quite a performing arts group and bringing in the acts from all over the country, if not sometimes overseas, that have come and performed for the people of Oswego. And I just appreciate everything they've done to support the city.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments? Hearing none, please call the roll.
Counselor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Counselor Enright?
Yes.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Todd?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Barlow?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Please call Resolution 490.
Resolution 490 would approve new sewer and water rates effective January 1st, 2016.
Councilor Todd, second. Councilor Walker, discussion.
It's a lot of people know all summer long about the problems that are going on with Eastside Wastewater, with the current water contract. It's a lot of people. It's not something that we really have. A federal judge mandates this. It's enforced by the DEC and the EPA. A couple weeks ago, they came and met with DevCode, who contacted us to say that with the work that we've done, that we don't have enough money right now in our account to meet the next wave of work that needs to be done with the consent decree. They originally proposed a ridiculous increase into the wastewater fund of what they wanted. Deb was able to work to try and get some of this down, and this is where it's at. None of us want to do this. It's a quarter for water, so we're it's ridiculous that they can't. For 40 years, for the last, I don't know, 6 years, no on this, and the federal judge will come in and he'll mandate we do it, or he'll fine us and we'll get the raise anyways, and they'll fine us again. Earlier this evening, everybody talked about trying to do the right thing because they were the right decisions that had to be made, and for 4 years we've tried to do that. I'm not happy about this. I fought all summer about it in executive session and warned that this was probably what was going to happen. If we didn't try and attack this aggressively, we did try and attack it aggressively, and they still hit with it. If we truly care about doing the right thing, the next group of councilors shouldn't be burdened with a decision. They're going to have to vote on it in the first week of January when they first get in here and burden them with that. Deb brought it to us. I don't have to bring it forward. The way I look at it, it's our problem. We were in office when we noticed it. And for me, I'll be supporting this. I'm happy about it, but it'll basically raise water and sewer fees by about $75, which is terrible, and I get it. The federal judge will mandate it. We're basically a formality, and there's nothing we can do about it. Sorry. I
apologize for it, but we don't have a choice. Any other comments? Councilor Kepulitz.
Yeah, I have some couple of questions on this, because this is the first time that I'm seeing this resolution and what is being suggested here. It looks like, and I can get the interaction from our chamber, and I appreciate that to help understand this. It appears that our flat rate will go from 222 to 275. That's the way, Mike, so $53 increase in flat rate. And the metered is going to go from 167 to 205. So they're increasing the base for metered. That increase is going to be $38. Which is also, and I would just suggest to folks, regardless of the outcome here, we really need to start looking, if you can, at metering your homes. You can see the outright difference right there, 275 to 205 for a flat rate versus a meter, and I understand why there's some folks that want to go flat rate. But when you go flat rate, that really you are going to pay an inordinate amount because you have essentially unlimited use of water and sewer, and it costs us to process every gallon, whether it comes through your faucet or it's treated at the water treatment facility. How much additional money are we looking to raise here, Ms. Coach? So you're looking to raise, with these increases, though, you're looking to raise a half a million or a million? The 1.5 million total is what you're looking to raise. That's what our shortfall is right now. If I may, this is my thought process on this one. I know, and we just, in Resolution 488, we just authorized the privatization of some of the sewer related, and I know we've had some other discussions about some other opportunities, and I also feel that those are discussions that need to happen sooner rather than later, because from what I understand and the discussions that we've had, there may be some significant savings in privatization. And I'm of the opinion right now, and I don't want to leave this for our new mayor or our new council, at some point we have to deal with this, and I don't, you know, I just feel that there's more work that needs to go into this. And looking at the ultimate objective here, which is to raise $1.5 million, I think you need to look at what privatization may offer the city in the way of savings, and I know that these numbers are going to have to go up. And I'm not quite sure that they need to go up by the number that's being proposed without doing a little more diligence on our part to see what opportunities there are for navigating that fund balance in other ways. And that's just my quick knee-jerk reaction, because I'm just saying this. So that's, you know, my sense is right now, I'm not going to vote for it. I think there's more work that still needs to be done.
Any other comments? Anyway.
Yeah. Again, this is the first time I'm looking at this, but I know what Councilor Todd has said is true. We're going to have to pass something like this coming down. There's no question. There's going to have to be an increase, whether we do it now or we do it next year. If we're going to stick it to the new council coming up, or we're just going to do what we have to do right now and go out. I hate to go out. My last resolution in my hand is going to be to raise the water bill. I mean, we got stuck with the tax increase. We got stuck with the consent decree, and now we have this, which, again, it was nothing we could do about it. Information that may have changed this was just way too late. Finding out this stuff at the end of the year, I'm not at all happy about it. I have a lot of questions about whether or not we could get some of this money through our commercial rates. Could we actually start, you know, charging commercial rates to some of these people instead of them paying the flat rates? I don't have the answer to that. I don't know if we have to pass it in. Deborah, are we looking at charging commercial rates on this? Well, I hope that this comes in front of the next council and does go somewhere, because I think it's only fair to the people of Oswego who has to foot this bill that we have a commercial rate built in there and not just flat rate for everybody. So I'm not happy with it. I feel the same as Council Kafowitz does. I think it needs a little work before this goes through.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? I guess I usually don't weigh in on these, but I do think I agree with Councilor Todd. This is something we're going to have to deal with. And the last thing I would like to do is start out a new council and a new mayor with raising taxes and suffering that controversy. It's something we have to do. I guess Councilor Enright and Kaplitz brought up some good points. you've done everything you could do. I'm concerned if we do pass this tonight, can we still go and revisit commercial billing? And I don't want to rush the judgment. At the same token, I don't want to burden Billy's administration.
The only thing I'll say about that, and while I agree with you, and I agree with everything Ron and Fran said, the DEC originally, when they came in here, wanted to do 1,000 a quarter when they came in. I believe every point that you guys have made is valid. I don't believe that this is going to be the end of their attempts to continue to raise these water and sewer fees. I think everything that you guys have looked at needs to be explored for the next group so that the next rate hike doesn't get, because there will be another rate hike. It's impossible for there not to be another rate hike. It's just impossible. For anybody who thinks that you can just vote no on this, you have no say on this. The federal judge out of Maryland comes in and says, this is what you're going to do. If you choose to vote no, he will charge you criminally, and he will fine your city. It's out of our hands. This is just a formality. We've been through this with the attorneys. We've been through this with the DEC and the EPA, and they've all told us the same thing. By all means, vote no. We'll just charge you criminally. It's your responsibility to do this. I think everything that you two have said needs to be done. I again stand by the fact, burdening the next administration in their first month when they're trying to get their feet wet, when they have no background or experience on trying to do this, is not the right decision to make. And I agree with your points that I wish I had more time. Deb has just found out about this within the last month. She's been trying to negotiate with them. She did a great job to get it down from where it was because of where they wanted to put it. If we leave this to the next group, let them get their feet wet and keep the next rate hike lower by doing everything you say, it is our responsibility to act prudently and not stick it on somebody else when they didn't do it. We've done the right thing for 4 years, and I'm not happy about the last thing I've got to do on the city council either is raise the water rate, but it's the right thing to do, and it's the responsible thing to do.
Yeah. No, Mike, I agree with you. I'm not saying that we should vote no, but again, this is the first time I'm looking at this. The question I have is, what's the rush? What's our deadline? We know we got to vote yes on it, but do we have to vote yes on it right now before we have a chance of looking into a couple of the concerns that Councilor Kapwitz and I have? Is that going to make a difference? If say we can get before the new council a different rate, say that may include a billing commercial rates in there that may reduce that amount that we have to pay down from 275 even down to 250. There's a lot of people on fixed incomes here that are going to be affected, and I really I want to do the right thing here. I just want to make sure that we're not rushing it, and that if we have the luxury of time, of a month, what is the deadline? That's what I need to know on this. Is there someone here that can answer that question? Is there we have to vote on this tonight, or can we explore some of these other possibilities? That's my question. Deborah, do we have a time? So this is it. Okay. So you answered my question. There isn't time. We have to do it since this is our last meeting. We have to do it.
Any other
Councilor Kapwitz? Yeah, Councilor Todd, I understand and I hear what you're saying totally. My concern is that 75 for flat and 205 for meters. If this could be 255 and 200, we need to look at every shaving, every dollar we can off that water rate. And I do believe that commercial is one where there is a potential to generate additional revenue from large commercial users that may be maybe subsidizing it as residential use. And I just feel that, we've never done anything in the dark. We've always had very good discussion about the reasons for or against a particular resolution. And I just feel that this discussion needs to have some thought put into it. I don't doubt that these have to increase. I wouldn't hesitate to do it if I knew that that was our only option, but I don't believe that's our only option. That's where I'm coming from on this. I think it has to happen. But what's the number? And that's the part that's troubling.
Through the chair, the chairman, you said this has to be done by the end of 2015. Let's just say we adopted these rates. Could the next council, one of the first acts of business, address all the concerns that Councilor Kaplowitz and Councilor Enright did to look at all that and then readjust the rates from there?
Well, I would
do the same for the other side, too. I mean...
But no, she says they have to be done by 2015.
But they could amend it.
Comments?
It can be prorated though for the building cycle, correct? It can be prorated in the building cycle. So if you only have two or three different.
Councilor Kaplowitz?
No.
Councilor Enright?
No.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd?
Yes.
Councilor Walker?
Yes.
Councilor Barlow?
No.
We have a tie.
Wow. So this is my decision. Well, I'll tell you, and I stated this earlier, I've been stuck in this position a few times. I'm comfortable with it by now. The last thing I want to do is, as long as there's flexibility in this going forward, what we're doing is, this is a point of order. We have to get it in just to make everything kosher. And I would rather break the tie in favor rather than have, you know, like Barlow start out with this chain around his neck. Like I said, we can change this. And discuss this again, but just following the chairman's point, we need to do this by the end of this calendar year. And if I have to break the tie, I will do this.
All right, the resolution passes 4-3.
Make a motion.
Second.
Roll, please.
I'll pass it off to me.
Can we give Councilor Enright a big how do you do on that too?
Councilor Kaplowitz?
Yes.
Councilor Enright?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Councilor Todd?
Mike?
Yes.
Councilor Walker? Councilor Barlow? Motion passes 6-0-1.
Meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everyone. We did, Michael.